In this segment, we'll talk about introduction to partial differential equations. You can get more details on this topic by going to this particular website here and clicking on the keyword and then clicking on introduction to partial differential equations. Let's go and see now what a partial differential equation is. If you look at this particular equation right here, what you're finding out that there is only dependence on one variable, which is x. So when you have only one independent variable in a differential equation, it is called an ordinary differential equation. However, if we have more than one independent variable, like in this case, we have x and y as the two independent variables on which u is depending on, we call that a partial differential equation. Let's go and look at a physical example to show when an ordinary differential equation governs the system and when does a partial differential equation. Here we have a simple problem of a spherical ball, which is right here, which is being submerged into hot water. And the differential equation which governs the system is given by this simple ordinary differential equation. In this case, theta is the temperature, t is the time, so we're trying to see that how temperature varies as a function of time, and it is dependent on parameters such as the mass of the ball, the heat capacitance of the ball, the convection coefficient between the ball and the hot water, the surface area of the ball, and what the initial what the ambient temperature of the hot water is, and subject to boundary conditions, or in this case initial conditions, we'll be able to solve this problem. However, to be able to write the model of this particular physical problem as an ordinary differential equation requires us to make an assumption that the ball is a lumped system, which basically means that we are assuming that the temperature everywhere in the ball is not a function of location. So at a particular time, the temperature in the ball is the same whether you're looking at a point on the surface of the ball or inside the ball anywhere, but it does vary with time, but not with respect to x, y, and z, or r, theta, and z, or r, theta, and phi, if you're looking at the three different coordinate systems which we are familiar with. So the number of independent variables which you have in this case is only one, which is time. Now we look at the same problem here. However, the only difference which we are making now is that the ball is not a lumped system, which basically implies that we cannot assume that this ball has the same temperature throughout the body at a particular time. Now, what is the difference between a lumped system and a not a lumped system is that is based on the assumption which we are trying to make is that the temperature will stay same throughout the body at a particular time, then it's a lumped system. If not, it's considered to be not a lumped system. But what makes a system to be lumped or otherwise is based on properties such as thermal conductance of the spherical ball, the convection coefficient which exists between the ball and the water, and also the geometry of the ball itself. But having said that, you can very well now see that the differential equation which is governing the temperature of the ball, which is in this case T, is now dependent on four parameters. It is dependent on your radial location, your angle theta location, your other angle phi location, as well as time. So we have now four independent variables in our differential equation, so hence making the differential equation to be a partial differential equation. Now, most of the differential equations, partial differential equations, which we cover in an introductory course on numerical methods, we generally limit our discussion to second order linear partial differential equations, which are of this particular form. And many of the physical systems do fall under that category. Now, we can get into more complicated systems, which are higher order, non-linear partial differential equations, but we have to get started somewhere. So generally people start with the second order linear partial differential equations, and there are some very classic physical problems which are associated with them. So a simple second order linear partial differential equation will have these constants A, B, C, and D, wherein A, B, and C, they can be functions of X and Y, only of the independent variables, whereas D has itself lumped not only the independent variables x, y, but also the dependent variable u, and it is first derivative with respect to x and y. Now, second order linear partial differential equations are classified into three categories: elliptic, parabolic, and hyperbolic. And what makes a particular second order linear partial differential equation to be elliptic, parabolic, or hyperbolic is very much dependent on the values of a, b, and c. So let's go and see some examples of that. So a particular second order linear partial differential equation is considered to be elliptic if the value of b squared minus 4ac, which is the coefficient of del 2u by del x squared, the coefficient of del 2u del x del y, and the coefficient of del 2u del y squared, if b squared minus 4ac is less than 0, then the equation is considered to be elliptic. Let's take an example of that. Here is a nice good Laplacian equation here. This is a good problem where you can find out the temperature inside a particular plate at steady state if you know the temperatures on the four edges of this rectangular plate, let's suppose. So the temperature in this particular rectangular plate will be given as a function of x and y and is determined by this particular partial differential equation. And in this case, as you can see, that this A, which is right here, will be equal to 1. Then you have C, which is right here, will be equal to 1. And since there is no del 2t del x del y term, B will be equal to 0. So once we put b squared minus 4ac, we get 0 minus 4 times 1 times 1 gives you minus 4, which is less than 0, hence making the equation to be elliptic. Now let's go and look at the other classification of when is a second order linear partial differential equation considered to be parabolic. Again, we go to the general form of the second order linear partial differential equation, and if b squared minus 4ac is exactly equal to 0, then the equation is considered to be parabolic. Let's take an example of that. A good example of that can be, let's suppose if you have a rod and you are maintaining this side at a particular temperature, let's suppose T naught, this temperature at, let's suppose, Tf, then what's going to happen is that the temperature in this rod is going to be a function of x as well as of time. And the temperature in the rod is given by a differential equation of this particular form. And in this case, now we have A, which is this term, which is K. B is 0 because there is no term such as this. C is also 0 because there is no term of del 2t by del t squared. And D is minus 1, but it doesn't come into the picture. So b squared minus 4ac will be equal to 0 minus 4 times 0 times k, and that gives us 0. Hence, the equation is parabolic. Let's look at the last type of second order linear partial differential equation, which is considered to be hyperbolic. Here again, we go to the general form of the second order linear partial differential equation. And if b squared minus 4ac is greater than 0, then the equation is considered to be hyperbolic. Now, this is a wave equation that if you have a string, for example, and you, let's suppose you fix it here, you fix it here, and let's suppose y is the deflection which you're measuring of the string, and you pluck it, then the equation of the deflection of the string, for example, while it is vibrating, will be given by a differential equation of this form, where y will be, of course, a function of the location, which is x here, and also vary with time. So in this case, what you have is a is 1 because this is 1, b is 0 because there's no term of del x del t, c is minus 1 by c squared because you have to take this to the left hand side, and that gives us b squared minus 4ac is equal to 0 minus 4 times 1 times minus 1 by c squared gives 4 by c squared. Since c squared is always positive, the quantity which we have here is positive. Hence the equation is hyperbolic. And that's the end of this segment.